Nintendo was in trouble. In the early 70s, they had taken a risky bet at developing their laser clay shooting system, an expensive entertainment system that had shown big economic potential, only for it to be completely crushed by something entirely unrelated. Halfway around the world, Arab countries had started an embargo of oil sales to several countries, including Japan, that generated absolute chaos in the Japanese economy and pretty much destroyed the financial future of the project. The debts amounted to the company were so large that many inside Nintendo feared their days were counted. Salvation, however, will come from two unlikely places. The first was the Game & Watch, a portable device by Nintendo's head engineer Gunpei Yokoi, and the second had been Donkey Kong, an arcade game designed by the then unknown Shigeru Miyamoto. Together, these two hits had saved the company and propelled Nintendo towards a new era dominated by technologically complex toys and games. But from the sidelines, one man watched, and as the success of his peers increased, so did his anxiety. His name is Masayuki Uemura, brought to you by the Curiosity Stream and Nebula Bundle. Uemura was an engineer originally from Shark Corporation who had been poached by Nintendo and appointed as the head of the new team of Research and Development 2, a division dedicated to hardware development. This young team had found some success already. The Japanese giant Mitsubishi, yes, that one, approached them to develop the Color TV game series of single-game home consoles, on which Uemura had learned a fair deal about product design. But the success of those consoles had been eclipsed by the colossal impact of Donkey Kong and the Game & Watch, to the point that employees of R&D2 were constantly leaving to work on the more promising rival team. For a while, Uemura found himself with so little to do that he would just go home early. But one of those days, president of Nintendo, Hiroshi Yamauchi, had something important to tell him. Uemura, we have to... Oh, I think he went home. Hello? Uemura, listen, video games are definitely the future, but we need to move away from the very sketchy reputation arcade parlors have. Nintendo's image is being ruined. What we need is arcade-like games somewhere more acceptable, like people's living rooms. Uemura could already feel his nervousness rising. Expensive American-style cartridge consoles hadn't quite clicked with the Japanese public, and their marketplace was saturated already with single-game models. This will not be easy. Finally, Yamauchi dropped the two most important details. It had to be priced at 10,000 yen and be ready by mid-next year. Toodles! As unreasonable as this order was, it was pretty much the only chance Uemura had to not become completely irrelevant in his company, and so he gave it a real swing. Okay, so capable of running arcade titles is a bit general, so this objective got simplified to being able to run Donkey Kong, Nintendo's arcade hit. But that did not make the challenge any less intimidating. Nintendo had licensed their arcade hits to many console makers before, from Amstrad to the ZX Spectrum, many of which were arguably not capable machines for this task. Although, you have to admire some of these coders. You have to do significant compromises in a port like this, and yet someone chose to give Mario a huge, well-defined ass. You have to respect that. Arguably, the only successful conversion was the ColecoVision port, which proved the difficult nature of this task. And finding someone that could make a CPU and integrated circuitry with this capability at such a low cost was hard. Nowadays, top-of-the-line CPU technology is so complex that there's literally a handful of companies that fabricate all the CPUs in the world. But back in the 80s, microprocessor technology was going through a boom, and lots of tech companies were trying to get on the game, especially in places like Japan. Sharp would have been an ideal partner, since Uemura himself had worked there, but paradoxically, Yamauchi unexpectedly forbade any collaboration between Sharp and Nintendo for the new console. The reasons are not clear. Maybe Yamauchi did not want Nintendo to over-rely on one partner. But the bad part is that every other company Nintendo reached out to basically laughed Uemura out of the room when they heard his price and functionality requirements. And just as he was beginning to think the project will be cancelled over pure inevitability, Nintendo's legendary fortune struck again. In Japanese, one of the interpretations of Nintendo's name is leave luck to heaven, as in work hard and leave luck to the gods. And for Nintendo, heaven seems to often be on their side. The photocopier and printer company Ryko was one of those companies that had inexplicably decided to jump into the microprocessor manufacturing business, expecting a goldmine. Millions were invested to create their factory, The gold mine had quickly turned into a nightmare, though. The lack of external contracts and Ryko's lower than expected sheep demand meant that rarely the factory was operating at over 10% capacity. Big and expensive factories are not free to keep around doing nothing, so Ryko executives were desperate to get something, any contract whatsoever, if only to keep the plant costs paid. Word had reached their ears of Nintendo's Uemura asking around for a company for a large order of microprocessors, so proactively, Ryko representatives reached out to Nintendo to get the details of the product. One of those people was Hiromitsu Yagi, an ex-Mitsubishi employee that had worked with Uemura during the TV game console project and, maybe out of desperation, assured Uemura that his absolutely insane requirements of a processor able to run Donkey Kong at a tiny price were possible. However, Ryko's proposal was unexpected in a number of ways. In a nutshell, they propose a very standard design that splits the task between two main parts, a cheap CPU that will interpret the game's logic and a custom-made PPU, or picture processing unit, that will take care of populating the screen with graphics. You can see for yourself evidence of this dual nature of the console within some of the earlier, simpler Famicom games, as you can notice how the chip containing the game logic and the one containing the graphics are literally wired to different halves of the cartridge. On the CPU side, they proposed basing the product on a MUS 6502 CPU. The thing is, this was a very, very weird proposal. But to understand why, let's take a short lesson in the early history of inexpensive CPUs. During this time, there were two major worldwide players in the fight for affordable 8-bit microprocessors, the Zilog C80 and the MUS 6502. The Zilog Z80 in particular had taken the Japanese industry by storm and was the CPU powering pretty much every big Japanese arcade hit. Pac-Man, Galaxian, Galaga, Donkey Kong, Donkey Kong Jr. You name a Japanese arcade hit at the time, and chances are, there's a C80 inside. But that microprocessor is not the one Ryko wanted to use. No, they wanted to use the other one, the 6502. This meant Nintendo will have no developers familiar with it, they will have to hire some in a country where barely anyone doing games knew what to do with it, and they could not recycle any code or logic from their arcade games, making the porting process much harder. On Nintendo's side, you can see why they accepted this weird proposal, they pretty much had no other options for manufacturers. But why was Ryko insisting so much on this CPU that had such clear disadvantages? And here's when things get really interesting. Most of my stories of this time come from the History of Nintendo Volume 2 by game historian Florin Gorges, on which it simply states that Ryko had the exclusive license for the MUS 6502 and they just used it. But this claim runs into several issues under scrutiny. According to I Am Error by Nathan Naltis, there's a lot of suspicious stuff happening around the Famicom CPU. For starters, the license for that CPU was owned by a company that could be considered a competitor to Nintendo. MUS Technology, the company that invented the CPU, was acquired by Commodore in the 70s, an acquisition they very much leveraged to succeed with aggressively priced computers using the CPU, including the legendary Commodore 64 that became the basis for a huge gaming industry. More importantly, Commodore CEO Jack Tramiel had significant interest in blocking Japanese competitors from eventually participating in the US games market, having several previous businesses fail against Japanese competition and, as some speculate, fueled in part by post-World War II anti-Japanese sentiment, something that is hard to fault him about with just a cursory read of his biography. So it is difficult to believe Commodore and MUS will have licensed their CPU to Ryko. And sure enough, a document explicitly stating that MUS licensed the 6502 to Ryko is yet to be found. Okay, suspicious? Sure, but none of this is quite groundbreaking. The real surprise came much later. Years after our story took place, when Nintendo finally started bringing their consoles to the US, people at Commodore suspected something weird was going on and got some of their engineers to investigate. Commodore 64 programmers Robert Russell and one of the original 6502 engineers, Will Mathis, investigated the Nintendo console and did some interesting discoveries. They scrapped the NES chip down to the die and discovered that it was exactly a 6502 with one major modification. The module that allowed for binary coded decimal operation was present but disconnected from the main chip. Okay, why is this important? Well, turns out the law that allowed chip designs to be copyrightable was established in 1984, that is, after the release of this device. That means that during the time our story takes place, if you wanted to legally protect a chip from copying, you had to use a patent. Now, if we take a look at some of the patents for the MUS 6502, the decimal operation functionality is a big part of it. So removing that functionality, even in such a crude way as just disconnecting from the model, was theoretically enough for Ryko and Nintendo to avoid a lawsuit from MUS. But the shenanigans do not stop there, because we still have to talk about the other main element of the design, the picture processing unit. Once again, in the book I Am Error, Nathan Altus points out that clearly the impressive ColecoVision port of Donkey Kong had left an impression in Nintendo, since this chip bears a striking resemblance in terms of functionality to the Coleco's video display processor, with the Ryko chip having very similar key functionalities and asset tables. Was this engineers simply drawing inspiration from a system they knew was nearly capable of the main task? Or was the very suspicious licensing situation of the CPU also being repeated here? It's hard to know, but one thing's for sure. Possible copyright infringement is only fun when Nintendo is the one doing. Either way, thanks to Ryko's desperation on getting their factory moving, they had made an offer to Nintendo that finally could make Yamauchi's impossible idea just viable enough, but Nintendo wanted more. Uemura left the key negotiations to Yamauchi himself, who boldly asked Ryko to sell their microprocessors at a mere 2,000 yen per unit. To get down to this absurd level of pricing, chip production would have to be in the order of millions, a number of video game systems rarely achieve in Japan. But Yamauchi was ready to bet on and guarantee millions of units, and that left Ryko executives worried. It is once again Hiromatsu Yagi, the ex-Mitsubishi employee, that reminds everyone that the Nintendo TV game units had sold at least a million units, and that the Game & Watch was a local phenomenon in Japan, and this was enough to convince his bosses to take the insane offer. The project had its manufacturer. For the games, Uemura's team found inspiration in another phenomenon taking place in Japan. The Walkman revolution had normalized the idea and aesthetics of cassette tapes as interchangeable units of media, and Uemura originally intended Famicom games to be the exact size of a cassette so people could reuse common cassette holders, but cost limitations on the size of the pins killed this idea. Almost everything else from the Famicom was decided by Uemura's team trying to save off cost. The controller was attached to the console to save on ports, the cable was shortened to save on cost, and even the color was the cheapest option. Maybe? Why the Famicom ended up being red is surprisingly complicated and no one knows exactly for sure. There are literally a bunch of competing narratives about this, so I just spun off that part into a Nebula exclusive companion video in order not to get too much sidetracked. What was a significant source of issues was the controller. This was way before any standard for controllers had emerged. Console controllers were all over the place, and the closest inspiration most Nintendo R&D2 designers had in mind was the Atari controller. But this had several issues. The stick was expensive to build and prone to hurting someone or breaking if left on the floor, so a better and cheaper alternative was needed. Thankfully, the answer was provided to Uemura from within Nintendo. His rival division, led by current Nintendo rockstar Gunpei Yokoi, had just introduced a Game & Watch version of the Donkey Kong arcade game that introduced a rather interesting Yokoi invention that allowed comfortable movement without a stick. It was way more durable, and more importantly, was way, way cheaper to manufacture. Uemura did not like the idea of asking Yokoi for help, but desperate to meet his deadline, he ignored his pride and asked him to help implement a similar mechanism for his console. Those of you who have watched the previous videos on this new series will find this ironic, considering the roles will reverse later on, and Uemura will refuse to help Yokoi with his Game Boy project, but that is a video I already made, so you can just watch that. For the moment, it's interesting how that D-pad will become basically one of the standards for video games for basically forever, with no major exceptions. Oh fuck, I had completely forgotten about this. Why do you keep doing this to Nintendo? Why?
We were on the verge of greatness. We were this close.
All in all, Uemura's team had produced a miracle of a machine in terms of features for the cost. And still, the final price of the unit came to 14,800 yen, significantly over the draconian 10,000 limited by Yamauchi. But just enough for Yamauchi to accept it and approve the product to move into production. After all, he was aware the console was going to be sold with the tiniest margins for the sake of being as cheap as possible, and that the real moneymaker would be the games. Uemura had done it. All that was missing was a name. The term console had not really entered the mainstream Japanese lexicon at that moment, so any console-like device that played video games will simply be called a computer. And then Uemura's wife had a great idea. If a PC was meant to mean personal computer, and this new device is a game computer meant for the living room for all the family to enjoy, how about family computer? Hey, you could even shorten it to Famicom, and it would sound nice. The history behind the name hides an interesting hint about the strategy behind the console. Uemura and his team were very aware that for their device to work, it needed to find appeal beyond children and into the whole family. This philosophy also guided the selection of a lot of the first set of games for the console, some of which were strategically chosen to appeal better to parents. And the name Family Computer accurately captured this intent rather well. Nintendo had spent a lot of money on this development, and Uemura was betting his entire career in this one move, and with bated and breath expected to hear from the initial sales. The story from the Famicom gets more complex from here. You will think, looking back, that it just goes up from here and Nintendo would just become the icon it is today, but there are a lot of unexpected twists and turns, which I might cover in a future episode of Low Spec Lore. What I also could not cover in this episode is the attempts to answer the question of why is the Famicom red? This appears simple on the surface, but in practice involves several conflicting sources, Yamauchi being his weird self, and a lot of office smoking. So I just spawned that off as its side companion video for this episode, which you can find in my streaming service, Nebula. Nebula is a streaming service created by myself and a growing number of creators to post all our content ad-free and some really, really good high-quality original stuff. For example, my plan is for every episode of this Low Spec Lore series to have a Nebula companion video on obscure side topics I could not fit on the main one. Then there's my documentary about Venezuelan RuneScape gold farmers. I also did an episode on a multi-creator collaborative series about game and show intros. And I decided to talk about the topic of why the first hour of Majora's Mask is the best playable storytelling ever done, and people should appreciate it more. And I already have several original projects in the works that you are going to love. Not to mention, we just launched our Roku app alongside the Apple TV app. And believe me, getting those done as an independent service was a journey.